Hi, and welcome to the FIFPRO podcast, Changing the Game. I'm Allie Riley. In this series, we'll be speaking to international female footballers about their personal journeys to success and find out what it's taken for them to reach the top of their game. And in celebration of the 30th anniversary of the FIFA Women's World Cup, we'll also be looking at how women's football has evolved over the last three decades and discuss what more needs to be done to protect the well-being of players and ensure that future generations can reach their full potential. Today, I'm talking with Yuki Nagasato.
After that, I completely lost my motivation to play football with my goal. It took like 1 or 2 years to find the balance.
Yuki is one of Japan's most successful players, competing at 2 Olympic Games and 3 World Cups, including being part of the World Cup winning team of 2011 and earning runners-up status in 2015. As well as her achievements at club level in her home country, her career has taken her around the world, and she's played for clubs in Germany, England, the US, and Australia, winning a host of championship titles in the process. In this episode, we'll be looking back at the Women's World Cup of 2011. Yuki, thanks so much for being on the Changing the Game podcast.
It's my pleasure.
It's nice to actually be able to sit and chat with you and not run around chasing you on the field for once. Let's get straight into it. It's an honor for me to be able to speak with a World Cup champion. And I know now so much has happened in the last 10 years, but 2011 wasn't actually that long ago. What memories come to mind when thinking of winning that World Cup and what it meant to you and to the country of Japan?
Yeah, it's hard to remember that we're winning the World Cup because it's 10 years ago. So
yeah,
it has been a long time, but I still cannot believe we won the World Cup. Still not.
Really?
No.
Why not? What was the mindset going into the tournament? Because you have always been, and you were then ranked, you know, one of the top teams in the world. But yeah, I guess you still weren't favorites to win the tournament.
As a team, we never dreamed to win the World Cup. But after the 2008 Beijing Olympic, we made a semifinal, first ever. Then our minds changed after the tournament. And everybody started to think about, oh, we are going to win the World Cup. This going to be next goal for us. But still, we didn't expect our performance. And we never thought we going to win the World Cup. But the mentality literally changed.
So you also scored the first goal for Japan in the World Cup against the great team of New Zealand. You know, it was very, very tight, very exciting game, 2-1. Have to mention that, of course. But
yes.
Do you remember that? Do you remember what it was like scoring in that game?
Yeah, I strongly remember the moment because personally, I really focused on getting first goal at the first match because I knew their first goal would be so important for us to go through the group stage. Mm-hmm. And New Zealand has been not easy to beat that we knew, you know.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, because you guys are always makes us too difficult to win the game. And we believed to beat the New Zealand always, but it was a very difficult game, as we know. But yeah, the first game made us really feeling we are going to slew the tournament.
And I was reading about the support of the fans. And obviously, with the national disasters happening in your country, there wasn't that much focus on the tournament. But I think when you finish the group stage with a 4-0 win over Mexico, there suddenly was a little bit of, you know, a little bit of attention, a little bit of excitement. And suddenly people were tuning in and realizing that, hey, there's something really positive going on that we should be following. For you, did you realize after the group stage, the knockout rounds, that you had a chance? Or was it not until the final where you kind of realized, wait, we might actually win?
So the third game of the group stage, we lost against England 2-0. That made us really like, oh, this is going to be more difficult, the knockout tournament, because the next opponent will be Germany, because we never beat them ever before. And then, as we know, they had a... So Germany has a ball and attacking 90% of the game. But they miss all the big chances. Somehow. I don't know why. Yeah, they were like not they supposed to be at all. So during that game, we felt, oh, this gonna be our game. And we kept believing. And the extra time we scored, finally. So still cannot be how we won the game. So it was a miracle.
So going into the tournament, what was kind of the view or the mentality around women's football in Japan? Because you have had this league for many years. You know, I've always been hearing about INAC Kobe, and I know that they're such good Japanese players. And we, as a New Zealand national team, we've played in Japan against Japan so many times and have so much respect and are very impressed by all of the players. But the league, I guess, is it professional? And at that time, going into 2011, what was the support like for women's football in Japan?
I think at that time wasn't enough support from the league or for their association, because we didn't have a professional league. That is still amateur league, and there's so many players still working except playing soccer. So we couldn't focus only playing soccer at the time. But the national team player always focused on not by ourselves, because our result impact to the future. That's our responsibility. That makes our mind really get high and high.
Did you see a change afterwards? Has the league progressed? Has the support progressed? I mean, winning the World Cup, that's such a big deal. And you see in the men's game what it does for federations and for the growth of the sport. Have you seen that in Japan since 2011?
I haven't seen at all. They never changed because they didn't expect we are going to win. And they have no idea what's going to do for the next step. So that takes so long time to get our professional league in Japan now. So it took, you know, 10 years. That's crazy.
Wow. Okay. But there is now a movement. The league now, is it more professional, or are all the players professional in the Japanese domestic league?
Yeah. They all professional player.
Okay.
They have now contract. Yeah. They didn't have a contract before.
Wow. Okay. So it took 10 years.
Yes.
Oh my gosh.
Oh no. Because people didn't want to be professional, because to be professional isn't secure the life, as I know. Then that means so much taking a leaks for the other player who also walking during the day with playing soccer. So they didn't want that risk. So that's why it takes so much time, because player didn't speak up.
So do you think little girls now who are growing up, well, having this league as a professional, even though it's been scary because it still is unstable and insecure, do you think the way the league is going and the way the national team is with players like yourself who are playing in top leagues around the world, do you think little girls now have a better idea that they can be soccer players when they grow up? Or do they dream about winning World Cups now more than they did before?
I think they can dream before then we won the World Cup, because, you know, there's this professional league and so much media is going on, and they can access any games in the world. And also, I think national team needed to win and show the good performance and like the goals, want to be part of the team. That's the next chapter we got to face on that. So, but yeah, 10 years ago, or when I was kids, I could not believe to be professional, because there is no professional league in Japan. Now it's very easy to dream to be professional in domestic league. So that's nice things, I guess.
Well, I read that you didn't actually love soccer when you were growing up, but you were maybe, you know, encouraged by your family to start playing, but it wasn't your favorite sport. Is that true?
It's true.
What did you want to be doing instead?
Nothing, because I had no choice. And, you know, when I was six, I didn't have anything like that I really into, you know, as kids. And I was feeling a lot of fear and pressure and mandated to play football. So I think because of my dad and the circumstance where I was in, and because my sister and brothers already started playing football, So that means I have no choice. But also I had nothing else to do, you know, except playing football. Yeah.
Well, they must have noticed that you were pretty good when you started playing.
So that's why my dad encouraged me to play soccer. But I didn't want, because I didn't want to do same thing with my siblings.
Oh, but then you ended up even playing club with your sister, right?
Sister and brother as well.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
Oh, so was it your brother's team, because you played for a men's team? Was that your brother's team?
Yes.
What was that like?
It was extremely fun to play with them, and it was my dream since 2010. So I told my brother at the time, I want to play in men's league one day. That's my goal.
Wow.
My brother still remember that.
And so how did it all come to happen?
So I was thinking after the Challenge Cup last year to play other place, mm-hmm. anywhere, in Japan or in Europe. And the idea came up instantly, like, oh, my brother playing in my hometown. Maybe I can ask to play with him, with that team. So, and then I started to ask him, oh, can I join?
It couldn't have been too hard of a sell to get a World Cup champion to come play on the team. What were his teammates, the coaches, and everyone that heard about it? What was the reaction like around your communities?
Well, the teammate and community were very normal to me. I felt nothing, any barrier in laces, nothing. But only the surprises of the media in Japan. It was like a big news. It became big news in Japan. So that supplied them during the practice, at the game. That was not normal for them. So only that part is very insane. That's it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's so interesting because I think that's what we're fighting for. And what we feel is, you know, no matter what you look like, the color of your skin, who you love, what you believe, you know, mm-hmm. soccer, sports, it should transcend all of those boundaries. But obviously society isn't yeah. there yet. And the reaction of the media showed that. And hopefully it's a good thing because mm-hmm. they wanted people to see what a cool thing you were doing was. But it's, you know, that's mm-hmm. normal for us. You want to play. You want to play with the best. You want it to be close to home. You want it to be with your brother. It was your dream. Yeah. So it was the best solution for you. And especially after the Challenge Cup and players didn't have teams to go to and it was hard and that was the perfect solution. But that's, yeah, that really shows with the reaction of someone outside your community and your bubble, how they reacted mm-hmm. to it.
Yeah.
So let's go back to the World Cup and how it was with what you knew had happened back home 4 months prior. So I think I read that before the semifinal, the coach showed you some really, really tough photos of what, you know, the tsunami and what had happened in Japan.
Yeah.
And then you went out and I think there was some reactions from the team saying that it was really tough, but then it made you proud too, to go out and play and bring joy to Japan.
Like we got feeling so much responsibility when we saw the video and picture, because we are literally representing the country, and you know, so many people still suffering in Japan, but we playing soccer in Germany and we safe, we don't have to suffer. So that kind of things made us, we gotta win more, like more that feeling. So that's why I think that kind of thing brought us next level, like a more reason to play.
Yeah.
So like for others, for the country, and we can clearly imagine that people we want to play for. So that helped a lot.
Yeah, it was really beautiful to see. Obviously, once we had been knocked out of the tournament, I think mm-hmm. you became clear favorites in terms of the team that everyone who was kind of neutral was supporting, because obviously I think you can understand that pressure, that responsibility you would feel. And also I think you could see when you unraveled that banner after winning, you know, to have that kind of gratitude, I think it set a really good example for the rest of the world and for athletes everywhere. And again, Japan won a fair play award, which usually the team that wins a championship is not the one getting the fair play award.
Yeah.
But again, too, I think you hear about how the Japanese national team, wherever you go, you know, the bench, everything is completely spotless. It's how it was, how you found it when you leave. The fans too, cleaning up after games. Is that something you speak about as a culture within the team, or is that just common sense and common courtesy for the culture of Japanese people in general?
So it's a very common sense for the Japanese culture. We always clean up to leave the room, anything in a hotel, even in the hotel and stadium, locker room, everything. That's our culture, always to be clean. So that comes very naturally.
Yeah. Well, I think as New Zealanders too, culture is really important to us, and we've taken a lot of inspiration from your team. And I think having a team that has those values, but also is so successful and so talented, you know, it doesn't have to be one or the other. To be a good player or a good athlete or a good team doesn't mean you have to sacrifice those values of being respectful and being grateful. And I know that we're all definitely behind you. And it was such an exciting final too. And we were back playing in the league in the WPS, and they were announcing the penalties and the goals. It was very, very exciting. So when you came home, or right after the tournament, what were those feelings like? And when you returned to Japan, were there any celebrations?
People were crazy at airport.
Good, you deserve it.
But remember, so when we left airport before the tournament, there were nobody, nothing. And after, I don't know how many people came to the airport, but that made us very proud.
Were there any parties? You got to give me the inside scoop here.
The domestic league, they still playing the league.
Oh, so everyone had to go back and play?
Yes. Like that week, they played a game.
Oh my gosh.
Yes. So at the time, I played in Germany. So after 1 week, I should have left. So there's nothing to do, any party.
So straight back into it.
Yeah. So that is also Japanese culture. Always walking, not taking less or party.
So how do you now find that balance, you know? Of course, you're talking about you have this culture with work, and now you have retired from the national team, and you have spoken about finding balance and protecting your mental health. And I see you're in, it looks like kind of a music studio. I know I was looking at your artwork and your stickers and your t-shirts, and I know you're a drummer. So how have you now found this balance with your work and play, or, you know, your outside of soccer life?
It took a long time to find this balance because I was really suffering to find the balance after the qualified tournament for the Olympic game for Rio 2016. After that, I completely lost my motivation to play football with my goal. It took like 1 or 2 years to find the balance. And so a person helped me a lot in talking every day, chatting every day, and guiding the way I'm supposed to go. And the talking the time was really helpful for me to find the balance. And also, I had an opportunity to move to the U.S. from the Frankfurt, where I played that time. And this culture made me think more, like, I don't have to think 100% about playing football, and started look other things which I really wanted to do except playing soccer. And I tried a lot of things.
Like what?
So first I tried painting, but I stopped somehow because it was not fun for me.
Mm-hmm.
But I started again during a pandemic. So that has been my joy, the one of the things. And I tried to wakeboarding.
Oh, wow.
Mm-hmm. But I cannot do constantly during a season because it's different location where you live. You can do that.
Yes. Yeah. And you need a boat and the water. Yes.
Yeah. And I tried to Aikido. You know Aikido?
No.
The Japanese martial arts.
Oh, wow.
Like kind of karate, Aikido.
Okay.
So I tried that, but I didn't become to like to do that. So that's not. So then I picked music.
Ah.
because my boyfriend played guitar and he invited me to join his band.
Wow.
And I joined as a keyboard because I used to play piano before when I was a kid. So, but I wanted something new because playing a piano is boring because it's not new. So then I picked drums because, you know, drama is very cool.
That's really cool.
So now it's drum and painting and also making some art stuff, the sticker. Also, so much filming and editing, like creative stuff that I love to do now.
Ooh, okay. And you find time, I mean, to do these extra things, do you find that you have to set aside time or you just naturally are able to, when you come back from training, you have energy because you're passionate about these other things?
Yeah, I always follow my feeling what I want to do after the training. And if I don't want to do that, I just don't do. Otherwise, always focusing on playing football. But for free time, always need to think about, you know, for the painting, I needed to sit or stand for a long time. That makes the legs so tired. And that impact to the field. So I don't have to do that because still my priority is playing football.
So did you notice then, you said you had kind of lost your motivation. When did you notice that you were actually getting excited about soccer? And do you notice this difference now when you're doing other things you love and you have other passions that you are enjoying your soccer more again?
I always was chasing the result and to score the goal because I was striker, the forward. Always people wanted me to score. So that was very tough and always need to think about to get score any result. And when I couldn't score and my emotion was like going down, so that made me really tired. And I started not think about result anymore after I came to the US. Then I started to focus on my purpose to play soccer. Why I want to play soccer? What I want to feel on the field. I started to think about it and I started focus on only that. Then my performance immediately increasing and I got feeling more joy to play and I got feeling more connecting with people and soccer. So that kind of like a switching made me happier and more joyful.
Yeah, that's such good advice. I think that's something that I hope we can, as athletes, encourage mm-hmm. other young players or all ages to have that kind of mindset because it changes your life. And yes. Like you say, it actually made you perform better.
Better, yes.
Do you notice a difference too, not being on the national team anymore? Does that also relieve some of the pressure and you have now this time when you're not having to go and travel so far from the US to go to camp all the time? How is your life different since leaving the national team?
Completely changed my life. Yeah, I didn't notice when I playing for the national team how much I sacrificed my mental health or my feeling to get the team better. But since I left, I started feeling less pressure and more relief and more enjoying life, not enjoying only the football life. So that retirement made me so much better life ever I had before. I didn't know that I was able to have this life ever. So I'm very glad I left the national team earlier time because, you know, I cannot imagine if I play until now, I couldn't find this life.
That's so important. So in the last 10 years, thinking about what you've learned and what you've seen and what you've experienced, what's something that you wish you could change for other female soccer players, whether it's in Japan or around the world?
I think you don't have to do the feeling that you have to do. Always you need to feel like you want to do it. Like that feeling makes so much difference, like inside your body and inside your mind. that makes your performance way better than if you feel you have to do. So that's what I want to say.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. I think that's a message that I really hope that we can get out there, especially with what we have been experiencing this season in the league and with what players have been experiencing. And that's why I think, too, we want to fight to make conditions better so that more players are feeling comfortable and safe when they are playing soccer. So then maybe there aren't as many who are really sacrificing so much just in order to do something they love. It kind of works both ways. You know, of course, if you're doing something because you don't love it anymore, your life won't be good if you keep doing it. But also, what can we do to actually make these environments and these cultures better so that players are feeling that they have balance and they're able to take care of their mental health, that they're treated how they should be treated, that there's the support. And I know, you know, both of our teams have been really vocal and the league this year in order to try to make things better. And I think I'm sure you agree, it's been pretty inspiring to be in the NWSL this year. It was pretty shocking coming back after all these years for me, but I'm proud of what the players have achieved this season.
Yeah.
I hope that we can continue moving forward in that direction. And with that being said, looking ahead to the 2023 Women's World Cup in New Zealand and Australia, what do you think the legacy of that World Cup will be?
So I think the things that's built up from that old generation, like our age, will be the legacy of the World Cup 2023. Because I think the World Cup will be the last one that a lot of legend players will play, like Mauta, Lupino. The generation has brought so much more things to the women's football world. And they changed the game and they changed the value in the world for women's football. And they definitely made it better for the young generation. So I think that will be the legacy for the 2023 World Cup.
And that will be a great legacy, I hope, in two beautiful countries.
Yes, in New Zealand.
Well, thank you so much for sharing all your amazing knowledge and racking your brain to go back to 2011 and your experiences in Germany at the World Cup.
Thank you so much, too.
That's all for this episode of the FIFPRO podcast, Changing the Game. If you've enjoyed this episode, please do like, subscribe, and review it, or maybe share it with a friend. Thanks for listening, and I'll see you next time.